in tiny loans, averaging about $220. And all this money comes from within the system of the bank. It's not taken from the government or some international organizations or some donors or anything. Every penny of this money comes from within the system. As a bank, we take deposits and lend the money to the poor people. Each branch is self-sufficient with their own money. They take the deposits and lend the money to the poor women. So that way, it doesn't have to go outside of its own operation to do that. Since it's owned by the borrowers, they sit in the board. They are the one who make up the board and make decisions about the bank. When I mentioned that we lend out $1.5 billion, and also it comes from depositors' money, the other interesting part of that bank is bulk of these deposits are the deposits from the borrower themselves. It's not deposits from outsiders. One of the basic requirements in Grameen Bank is that every week, every borrower is required to put tiny little money in savings. Whatever tiny amount you can afford, put it in your account. Everybody has a savings account, has several savings accounts actually. And they put their money into that savings account, and it becomes a habit after a while. When you put tiny money in a regular way, collectively it becomes a huge money. Today, the balance in the deposits of all the borrowers put together comes nearly $1 billion. So it's not small money that comes from the borrower themselves. So if you look at it, it's their own money they borrow, actually. There are 2,600 branches of Grameen Bank, and more than 500 branches there are where the amount of deposits of the borrower far exceeds the loan they have taken from the branch. So when my colleagues refer to them that our borrower has done this, our borrower does this, and I said, please don't refer to them as your borrower, because actually you are the borrower. They are the lender. So the role has changed. If you look at the broader way, about 75% of the branches of Grameen Bank runs the lends money, the loan that they give out, bulk of the money, at least 70% of the money, is their own money. So you can imagine, it's a relationship, it's not just a one-way lending money, it's a both-way thing, and builds up that whole capacity. When my friends in business world kind of make jokes about poor people, small loans, and kind of that kind of thing, how far they can go, I said, don't ignore them as some small borrower borrowing $200 or $250 or something like that. If you look at them, they have enough money in their account to buy up your company several times over. So that's the strength they have already achieved. This is something brought into them, and that gives them the enormous amount of confidence in their life, what they want to do about it. This part of the story on the microcredit has spread, and many people got inspired, want to do things. It is all over the world now, it runs bank. And I was in Glasgow Caledonian University in 2009, and Pamela Jules, she became very interested in our work. She wanted to do a Grameen program in Scotland. That was the beginning of our relationship with Grameen's program with the Glasgow Caledonian. Out of that came many programs. One is a nursing college that we do together in Bangladesh. We set up a nursing college, Grameen Glasgow Caledonian Nursing College. And one of her colleagues, dean of nursing college, has become the principal of that college. She volunteered to become the principal of that college. So it's a very strong relationship. It's a beautiful nursing college now. First batch of graduates will come out of the college this year. So you can see it's not simply talk, it's already in action. And the other part is a microcredit operation in Scotland that we are preparing for. Hopefully this will be launched very soon. And then one idea that was coming, that to create not only we'll create, already created, the Center for Social Business in Glasgow Caledonian University, with the chair for social business. So many things have happened in the meantime since December of 2009 and now. So this is gradually now opening up more and more responses from other directions to how to address broader issues of the problems that faced in Glasgow and other cities in Scotland. When we did Microcredit Grameen Bank, I was very closely associated and meeting all those borrowers, meeting people. As you come close to the poor people, you gradually see many things that you don't see from outside. And suddenly you get drawn into these things and you feel frustrated that this is not working in their life. And one of the first things that drew my attention was something I had never believed that it could be such a widespread thing among families. Night blindness. Children cannot see at night. They become blind at night. I had no idea that something such a phenomenon existed. So I was very curious because I don't understand why kids cannot see, they go blind. So I started talking to the doctors, what is the problem? They said it's a disease, it's called night blindness. It is caused by vitamin A deficiency. And I said, how do you cure them? Is it done? Their eyes are gone? They said, no. If they take vitamin A, they will regain their health and their eyes will start seeing just like anybody else. Then they advised me to take vitamin A tablet, or maybe you can encourage them to take vegetables as during their diet, particularly colored vegetables that have a lot of vitamin A. So we debated among ourselves whether we go for the tablets or we go for the vegetables. Then I insisted, let's go for the vegetables, because tablets will get again another habit that you have to buy things, you have to go to doctors or whatever, marketing becomes a problem. But vegetables, they can grow, it become part of their dietary habit, and then this is over with. So we started talking to our borrowers, this is a solution, we do that. Well, we don't have any seeds, how do we grow those kind of things? So we started delivering that seeds. Then our idea was, why don't we put them in tiny little packets and sell it to them? Make it less than a penny per packet so that nobody feels that I couldn't buy it because it's expensive. And it became instant success. People loved it. They wanted to grow it because Bangladesh soil is fertile soil. They grow and immediately they can have beautiful vegetables. And as we grew, the demand for seeds became so big. Very soon we'll become the largest seed seller in the country. And we are very happy that people are really enjoying it and feeding the children and themselves eating and just selling these vegetables at the same time, because there's enough to eat at the same time you can sell. And in the process, night blindness disappeared from the country. And as I see every one of them, like for example, toilet habits. In a country like Bangladesh, you don't have a toilet habit that you would like expect. They just go out in the open. And diseases are spread everywhere because of this openness. So this worried us, because how do you stop this kind of habit? It's a traditional habit. Just don't worry about any toilet. So we went back to the borrowers to explain how important it is. They say that, but nobody takes any action. Then we made it a rule that if you want to join Grameen Bank, you have to dig a hole and use it. And literally when they said, well, I would like to join Grameen Bank, we said, okay, we'll come and check your house, whether you have a toilet. And it became an obligatory thing. And people in the beginning, people were protesting, why do you insist on that? We said, look, this is the way we work. You cannot join Grameen Bank unless you have that thing. And then we introduced the loan for setting up sanitary latrines. It's a very simple thing with three rings and a slab. You can build it. It doesn't cost much, but we started giving loans for sanitary latrine. So it became part of Grameen Bank habits, Grameen Bank rules. If you join Grameen